this particular group has managed to put us together as never before. Next steps after the Supreme Court, first one is recalls. Absolutely recalls. All day, every day until we take back the Senate. Because I believe we should have three branches of government and not just one.
Lee, what do you see as the way that the national labor groups were able to help? And were there any times where you think it was better to have this actually sort of stay local, either from an organizing or a communications perspective?
Well, this was clearly a local fight, but they require and need national assistance as far as resources and keeping people coming in to help develop a strategy and help develop a plan. But clearly, our folks in Wisconsin, the unions that were working very closely together in Wisconsin, but just as important, the students and the community organizations and the progressive community, and all of you, the bloggers. I mean, we could not have done it without you and without the support that you gave us in Wisconsin. We've got to continue that momentum, continue that aggressive behavior, not only in Wisconsin, but across this country.
Social media in both communication and in making sure that the message was clear was just phenomenal. We went from 62 interactions on our Facebook page in January to 26,000 in those first 3 weeks of February. And that's just our case. That's not all of the rest of the bloggers who were a part of this and made sure people knew what was happening, not just in Madison, but across our state.
Now, how did you know, because you spent, like so many labor leaders, local leaders, you spent most of your life not doing professional politics, right?
No, I was a junior high school teacher, and that's what I know.
Right. So how did you make that bridge? And talk to us about how useful it is to have a mix of, obviously, national folks and people with money to spend, that's real, but also someone like yourself who is not by any means doing strategy all the time per se, but join the fight because it mattered to you and your schools.
Well, it absolutely is critical. Our national organizations were great in helping us with what they knew about strategy and what they knew about connecting. But the connections that we had were what our members have every single day, because they're the people on the job. They are the working families in our communities. But it was figuring out how to make sure they knew and had the confidence to tell their stories, because it is in the everyday stories of what our members do that those connections and the community connections to the value of working families across the state are going to be kept.
And I would just add that we're really using the experience in Wisconsin is a model to fight back in other states across the country, whether it's in Ohio or Michigan or Florida. There's no cookie cutter approach, but we can learn lessons from what our sisters and brothers did in Ohio. And I think one of the most important things we can do is to participate and work very hard in rebuilding a movement. And it's not just the labor movement. Got to work some work to do in the labor movement, but we've got to rebuild a progressive movement in this country to fight back and make our voices heard like never before. I mean, we cannot bury our heads in the sand and expect that this is going to go away. I mean, these folks are like the flu. They will come back at us every single year. They are not going to give up, and we've got to be just as dedicated, just as committed to moving a progressive agenda in this country.
Really was that when we went about those recall elections that I say are so important, it was our community members, it was our folks. We didn't have to bring in national folks to do the recall petitions. They were done by community members. The other side didn't have that. They hired and they brought in people from outside. When our people could do that work and they were motivated to do that work, unfortunately, because this is the most radical agenda we had seen in Wisconsin in our history.
Now, what do you see as the outlook there for those recall races, which a lot of people are following closely?
I'm extremely optimistic, both because the drive petitions were done by members in those districts, and because this particular governor and legislature just don't stop the extreme agenda. And that is not the way Wisconsin citizens see themselves. It is not the way they want their government to work, and they will reject those votes.
We're going to win in Wisconsin, make no mistake about it. I view this as an opportunity. We're going to win in Wisconsin, and then we're going to go in Ohio, where we have a ground attack there in Ohio. We push for a referendum that will be on the ballot in November if we get enough signatures. is required to have 232,000 signatures in Ohio. We've got 2 weeks left within our signature campaign, and guess what? It was reported yesterday that we have 714,000.
Exactly.
We've got close to a million signatures in the state of Ohio. And we're going to win in Ohio also. And we've got to carry this energy, carry this momentum, and do all of the things that we've done in Wisconsin and Ohio. We've got to do it in other states across this country and keep this energy moving and moving to 2012.
Now, I want to draw a contrast. Something that a lot of people here may remember was when Tom DeLay, before he went to jail, was organizing a mid-decade redistricting effort in Texas in 2003. And there were legislators there, Democratic legislators, who fled the state in protest. Because again, we have these situations where at the state level, we have a type of corruption of the democratic and voting process itself within these legislators. And while it was a big deal to some people at the time, I think it's fair to say it got nowhere near the attention nor the post-mobilization that this effort did with the Wisconsin 14 and everything else. If either of you remember that or have any thoughts on that contrast, why don't you tell us about why this has galvanized so many more people?
Well, it was such a radical piece. The redistricting in Texas was bad, and they took the opportunity that they had to try and slow that down. But when our Senate 14 left for Illinois, it really was an agenda that would be pushed in 4 days had they not taken that action. And those men and women decided that they were the only thing to stand between Governor Walker and moving that agenda so quickly that the people of Wisconsin wouldn't have a chance to even have their voices heard.
I also think that people understand now that this is a coordinated attack that's been planned for months and months and months, not only in Wisconsin, but state after state after state across this country. And people believe that there is an overreach, and they're going way too far. And people are galvanized, and they want to be engaged in this fight, engaged in this battle. And it's up to you in this audience, and it's up to all of us to continue that engagement, continue that level of engagement, and continue to fight back like never before.
Well, and the last question I want to ask for you two, and then we've got two more great guests after the commercial break, is what we've seen, I think, successfully in the short run here is also a different definition of the opponents in this fight. It is not just people who are really concerned about the budget shortfall or the 30-year austerity plan for the deficit. It is also people like the Koch brothers who become something like the opposite of celebrities, infamous, not famous, who now are being pulled into this fight accurately when you look at their role and the money they've spent. But that also, I don't think, was the case even a few years ago. Tell us about that. Who do you see as your opponents in this fight as our final question?
Well, it's been really clear since early in this that it wasn't about money, and that the people who constantly wanted to make it about money had a completely different agenda and a different set of backers. It was, in fact, in outing the connection with the Koch brothers through Frank that it became very clear to people, and we knew all along that was there, but it's making sure that everyday citizens understand it was never about them, it was never about the Wisconsin budget, it was never about money, it was about the Koch brothers and their friends with a very different agenda for what they wanted and who they cared about, because they don't care about Wisconsin's working families.
Make no mistake about it, this is a power play. It's a power play, pure and simple. It's a power play by the Wall Street barons, by people like the Koch brothers. And again, I believe that all of us have a responsibility to work and fight like never before. We've got to determine, this is a much bigger question than collective bargaining rights in the state of Wisconsin. It's a much bigger question. It's about the direction that we believe this country must move. And are we going to continue to move forward? And will we fight to move forward for decent wages, decent benefits, a decent education, health care for all? Or are we going to listen to those few who want to continue to decrease the numbers in the middle class and hurt working families? And I've got to say that we've got to stand up like never before, and we've got to fight back like never before to make sure that doesn't happen.